Hi, my name is Gabe. I'm a mathematician and a tutor, and I'm excited to dive into some statistics with you today. Today's topic is continuous random variables. We will start this video by discussing random variables in general and how they are used to talk about probabilistic events. We will then specify what it means to be a continuous random variable. Finally, we will discuss the properties of continuous random variables and how to evaluate events which are modeled as continuous random variables. As we get ready to discuss continuous random variables, we need to think about why we need random variables in general. It seems like it's possible to say that a coin flip is going to be 50-50 without talking about any variables, so what's the point? In short, random variables mathematically connect probabilistic events to numerical values. We model events as draws of a random variable with a certain underlying pattern or probability distribution. Crucially, random variables provide a way for us to talk about all types of random circumstance using a unified mathematical language. This means that we can talk about the outcomes of a roll of the dice and how long you have to wait for a bus if you show up at the station using the same general structures. In general, when the results of an event are restricted to a limited list of countably distinct variables, such as the possible values that you can roll on a die, we refer to that as a discrete random variable. If an event can lead to an uncountable number of outcomes across some interval, such as your random waiting time, which can be anything from no time at all to however long the gap between two buses is, we remodel that event as a continuous random variable. Let's focus on continuous random variables in this video. Definitionally, a continuous random variable is a random variable that can take on a value from an uncountable set along some interval. Examples include the waiting time for a bus or the height of a person. Yes, in both cases, we may measure the outcomes in certain units, such as rounding the waiting time to minutes or the height to inches. Still, with a fine enough timer or ruler, we could get arbitrarily specific in our measurements. Even if you may not count on your watch, to a continuous random variable, there is a big difference between 60 seconds and 60.001 seconds. This degree of accuracy brings us to a key property of continuous random variables. Since continuous random variables can take on arbitrarily precise values, probabilities for continuous random variables only make sense on intervals. In essence, the probability that you are going to wait pi minutes is zero. Eventually, if you record enough decimal places for your waiting time, you will disagree with any exact measurement. Rather than asking something like this, we can ask what the probability is that you wait somewhere between 3 and 3.5 minutes. The result might be that we end up waiting for 3 minutes and 14 seconds, but predicting that exact result is meaningless. The probability of seeing any arbitrarily accurate result will be zero. To get a non-zero probability, you have to ask something about an interval. Let's formalize the notation that we use for this. The continuous random variable itself is represented by a capital Latin letter, generally X. We write the endpoints of an interval on which we want to discuss the random variable as lowercase a and b, and we write down the probability of an outcome within an interval as the probability of a less than or equal to x less than or equal to b. A will always represent the lower bound of the interval and b the upper bound. When we want to define these probabilities for a continuous random variable, we will need to use a probability density function, which we generally write as lowercase p of lowercase x. In general, a probability distribution function connects the possible outcomes of a continuous random variable to probabilities between 0 and 1. There are many specific probability density functions throughout statistics, the most famous of which is likely the standard normal distribution, or bell curve. The probability density function of the bell curve can help us discuss the most important properties of PDFs. The standard normal goes from negative infinity to positive infinity, and the probability that x is somewhere in this interval must be 1. All this means is that the probability of the random variable being within the bounds of its possible options is 100%. In the math of probability density functions, this just means that the area under the curve of the PDF must be equal to 1. To ask something like what is the probability that x is between 0 and positive infinity, we would be restricting ourselves to only look at the area under the positive half of the curve. The standard normal is symmetric, so this will only be half of the total. This is also the equivalent of the total shaded area on the graph. This property is crucial to the math of probability density functions. This type of analysis does generally require methods from calculus, but current statistical software or tables can provide values for most relevant distributions. Let's work on a simpler distribution that won't require any of these tools. To do this, we are going to describe our bus station situation as a problem associated with a uniform distribution and a random variable x for our waiting time. Let's say that our bus runs on 20-minute intervals, so if we arrive exactly when it does, our waiting time is 0 minutes, or if we arrive just as it leaves, we have a waiting time of 20 minutes, giving us values of 0 and 20 for A and B respectively. Finally, we can define our probability density function as p of x equals 1 over 20. On a graph, this is simply a flat horizontal line indicating that you are equally likely to arrive at any point along the interval. When we observe this distribution on a graph, it is rectangular with a height of 1 over 20, or 0.05, and a length of 20. To confirm that this is a proper probability distribution, let's calculate the area. The shaded area is equal to the height times the length. In our case, this is equal to 0.05 times 20. Multiplying this out leaves us with our area of 1. We can then interpret this in terms of a probability of waiting between 0 and 20 minutes by writing that the probability that 0 is less than or equal to x, which is less than or equal to 20, is equal to 1. Now, we can ask ourselves something like, how likely is it that the bus will come within 5 minutes of our arriving? Pause the video for a moment to think about what probability we have to calculate in terms of our probability interval. Now, a common mistake would be to write down something like probability of x is equal to 5. This is incorrect because this is an exact value and the probability of observing any single exact value is always 0. In our case, we have to write down the probability that the random variable x lies between 0 and 5. Consulting our probability density function, this section of the PDF stretches from 0 to 5 for a length of 5 with the same height of 0.05. Now, the smaller shaded area is equal to the height times the length. In our case, this is equal to 0.05 times 5, giving us an area of 0.25. 25 corresponds to the probability of waiting between 0 and 5 minutes. That is, we have a 25% chance to wait less than 5 minutes. Hopefully this has given a brief look into making use of probability density functions for interpreting the probability of continuous random variables. Before we wrap up this lesson, just one specific vocabulary point. Continuous random variables have probability density functions, while discrete random variables have probability mass functions. This lesson began with a brief discussion of random variables before continuing on to discuss continuous random variables. In particular, we emphasized how important it is to specify that the probability outcomes for continuous random variables are only meaningful when evaluated on an interval. Finally, we took some time to discuss probability density functions and how they connect continuous random variables to probabilities. We emphasized some of their properties, including how the area under the curve of an entire PDF is 1, and how the area under an interval corresponds to the probability of finding a continuous random variable along that interval. Overall, this video has just been a brief introduction to continuous random variables. For more examples and specific forms of these continuous variables, I encourage you to keep learning about them in various places on Chegg.